Dit is Papa Alpha 0 Echo Tango Echo. Optimisme is een verantwoordelijkheid als er een natuurramp gebeurt. Vertrouw jij dan je leven toe aan het feit dat mobiele telefoons en internetverbindingen nog werken? Vertrouw je daar het leven van je gezinsleden aan toe? Ik dacht het niet. Amateurradio. Communicatie die altijd blijft werken. Goedenavond, dit is de lange uitzending van de Daily Minutes, ook bekend als PA00 Nieuws. In deze wekelijkse uitzending beginnen we met de 5 meest recente Nederlandstalige afleveringen van de Daily Minutes, zoals uitgezonden via PI2NOS. Vervolgens komt de Amateur Radio Newsline met de datum van deze vrijdag met wereldwijd nieuws over onze hobby in het Engels. Aan het eind van de uitzending zenden we de Deutschlandrundspruch uit, het landelijk nieuws van die week van de Duitse amateurvereniging DARC. Deze bijdrage is in het Duits.
Amateur Radio Newsline Report number 2137, with a release date of Friday, October 12th, 2018, to follow in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. The following is a QST. Hurricane Michael targets the southern U.S., Yellowstone National Park celebrates a new repeater. And what's this about lizards on the air? All this and more as Amateur Radio Newsline Report 2137 comes your way right now.
From around the world, this is Newsline, Amateur Radio's independent on-the-air news and bulletin service. Now, reporting from Valparaiso, Indiana, here's Paul Brown, WD9-GCO.
We open this week with breaking news. As Amateur Radio Newsline went to production, northern Florida was being slammed by Hurricane Michael. The ARRL asked field organization leaders to keep them apprised of its emergency frequencies, activation status, and any requests for equipment to assist if necessary. WX4NHC, the amateur radio station at the National Weather Center, was activated as of early Wednesday, October 10th, as was the VOIP Hurricane Net and the Saturn Southern Territory Single Sideband Net. The Cuban Federation of Radio Amateurs reported emergency nets were up and running on 40 and 80 meters in digital modes and on single sideband. The storm was expected to make landfall on the Florida Panhandle and hit southern Alabama. South Central Georgia and North Carolina declared a state of emergency. The VOIP Hurricane Net requested that hams in the hurricane's path or with relay messages into it provide surface and damage report for relay onto WX4NHC. For story updates, please visit Amateur Radio Newsline's page on Facebook. There's a new forum especially for newcomers. Ed Durant, DD5LP, has that story.
The amateur radio satellite community keeps growing, and so does the number of satellites. Now the universe of online satellite forums has also grown and added one more venue, as reported by the president of AMSAT Deutschland, Peter Gulsow, DB2OS. He has announced on the AMSAT bulletin board that the new forum is geared especially towards newcomers in the hopes of opening up new experiences for amateurs and sharing encouragement and tips for first-timers. Although AMSAT Deutschland is hoping as many people will register as possible, guests are also welcome to stop by and visit. The topics are expected to be extensive and are designed to encourage wide-ranging discussions. Peter noted that especially with the launch later this year of Qatar's S-Heil 2 communication satellite and its amateur radio payload, there's plenty of room for more satellite communicators. AMSAT DL has been providing the commercial Qatari satellite project with technical support. Once it is in orbit, it will be capable of linking hams from Thailand to Brazil and will supply the first amateur radio geostationary communications. Satellite enthusiasts or hams who would like to become one can find the forum at this address, forum.amsat-dl.org. For Amateur Radio Newsline, this is Ed Durant, DD5LP.
Our next story celebrates a silent key who music fans may have only known through a song lyric. Andy Morrison, K9AWM, explains.
Music lovers of a certain age will remember Buddy Holly's classic hit Peggy Sue from 1957, and certainly Texans of a certain age might even have known Peggy Sue Guerin, the young girl from Lubbock, Texas, who inspired the rockabilly number. Amateur radio operators of a certain age, however, may remember Peggy Sue as the former K5 PSG. First licensed as KE5AKW in 2004, she was able to get the vanity call later. She wasn't exactly an aspiring ham, however, when her former high school classmate Holly turned her into a song lyric. Holly died in 1959 in a plane crash that killed two other rock and rollers. When she took part in the special event station W5B in Lubbock, which commemorated Holly in 2004, she was hooked and got her ticket later that year. Though her license expired in 2014, we can still consider Peggy Sue Guerin a silent key. She died on October 1st at the age of 78. For Amateur Radio Newsline, I'm Andy Morrison, K9AWM.
Look up in the sky. It's time again for Parachute Mobile, as we hear from Mike Askins, KE5CXP.
Parachute Mobile is what a team of skydiving hams for whom going on the air means being in the air are calling themselves. They are holding the last of this year's missions on the 20th of October to coincide with Pacificon, the Pacific Division Conference of the ARRL, taking place in San Ramon, California. While the hams make their jumps from a small plane elsewhere, the team will have a presence at the Marriott Hotel, where a GOTA station will be set up to help convention goers make contact with the skydivers. Two overhead monitors will also live stream the action as the jumps happen, starting at 10 a.m. local time. This will be Mission 33, and the jumpers will be Mark, AF6IM, and Rob, KC6TYD, using their own call signs as they call QRZ from beneath their parachutes. They'll be operating on 146.430 simplex, 14.250 on HF, and on Echolink at NE6RD-L. Hams who make contact are being asked to send an email to skydivinghams@gmail.com with details such as the jumper's name, the jump number, and the time of contact. Rob, KC6TYD, told Newsline in an email that this wraps it up for the team for this year. So in this case, the team truly is jumping to conclusions. For Amateur Radio Newsline, I'm Mike Askins, KE5CXP.
If you think newcomers to the hobby can't make a difference, guess again. Neil Rapp, WB9VPG, shares this tale of a triumphant repeater project.
Yellowstone National Park was the first national park in the U.S. It's around 63 air miles north to south and 54 air miles east to west. About 4 million people visit the park each year. With a park this size in a sparsely populated area, communications options are slim at best. But that's where ham radio comes in. About 3 years ago, Michael Coulter, W8CI, the spokesperson for the Dayton Hamvention, and his wife Linda, W8AAV, were asked to teach a class on amateur radio at a ranch in Paradise Valley, just outside of Gardner, Montana. They programmed a 2-meter radio with all the repeater listings for the region they could find. They were shocked when they arrived.
I was using 50 watts. But it's pretty depressing. I could not make any contacts at all. Couldn't even light up any of the repeaters. And so this kind of led us to begin mapping out ideas of how to impossibly where to place a 2-meter repeater in such a way to cover large areas of the park. We really emphasized just how important this repeater could be for the region.
Despite the absence of a repeater, 25 eager students took up the challenge of learning about amateur radio. Linda put her teaching skills to use, and the class graduated some new hams in a 2-day crash course. And recently, they learned of some other fruits of their labor.
I got an email the other day that was just absolutely astonishing that the group of them had worked really hard, and they started NYARC, North Yellowstone Amateur Radio Club, and it's recognized as a nonprofit in the Montana Corporation. So that just happened on August the 1st. So giving these classes, I want to recognize that my wife is a professional teacher, and she really worked hard with Lauren Clark, KB1Y Delta Delta at ARRL, and also with Gordon West, and had a lot of his material and CDs in tow, as well as Ward Silver's book. So So that was what we used, and she had mapped the whole program out. And now, if you're a rail gardener, actually, if you're anywhere from on Highway 89 from Livingston all the way to the other side of Lamar Valley, and that's only 10 miles west of the Silver Gate entrance. Beautiful, beautiful part of Yellowstone. But it has a coverage on the repeater is 146.98, and that has a 100 hertz tone. So tune into that. Actually, they are having, they're very active with nets and things like that, and there's usually somebody monitoring that. Very exciting to see that take place.
So now if you're in Yellowstone, there's no longer a need to ask. Can you hear me now? For Amateur Radio Newsline, I'm Neil Rapp, WB9VPG.
Time for you to identify your station. We are the Amateur Radio Newsline, heard on bulletin stations around the world, including the KJ3LR repeater in Bradenton, Florida, on Fridays at 10 p.m. This is probably the busiest time of the year for the young hams in radio scouting, and Bill Stearns, NE4RD, tells us why.
This week in radio scouting, we're 1 week away from the largest scouting event in the world. Jamboree on the Air is the weekend of October 19th through the 21st. All bands and all modes look and listen for CQ Jota. If you're an amateur and have not gotten involved yet, contact your local club. If your local club is not participating and you still want to, contact your local scout council and see what may already be planned in your area and how you can help. You can find your council using the council locator on the scouting.org website. If nothing is currently planned, or if current plans aren't reaching your area, you can work with the council or a local unit, pack, troop, or crew to set up a Jota station or arrange for visits to your ham shack. You can also participate just by making QSOs with the many Jota stations that will be on the air. Currently registered stations around the world is approaching 3,000, while stations in the U.S. is approaching 400. Get your station locked in today and get registered through our shortcut at jota2018.k2bsa.net. It's never too late to be involved. For more information on Jota or radio scouting, please visit our website at k2bsa.net. For Amateur Radio Newsline and the K2BSA Amateur Radio Association, this is Bill Stearns, NE4RD.
Hams in California's Bay Area are getting ready for a day of discovery as we hear from Dave Parks, WB8ODF.
For members of the Sonoma County Amateur Radio Club in California, the 8th annual North Bay Science Discovery Day on October 27th may as well be called North Bay Radio Discovery Day. During the festival's hours from 10 a.m. till 4 p.m. local time at the Sonoma County Fairgrounds, the club will be operating special event station K6S, hoping for contacts on 10 meters, 20 meters, and 40 meters. They'll be operating the station to demonstrate radio to anyone and everyone who stops by. Club Activities Coordinator Daryl Paul said he's working on a special event QSL card as well for the event. Meanwhile, SCRA member Keith Paye, AG6CI, will be talking about satellites, satellite signals, and demonstrating how radio astronomy works using what he calls his IBT, Itty Bitty Telescope, a converted satellite TV dish. He's also hoping to show his portable Super SID system, SID for Sudden Ionospheric Disturbance. The device uses software on a laptop to display a real-time spectrum of signals between 0 and 48 kilohertz, a range that includes U.S. military signals around 25 kilohertz. Keith, who's a director of the Society of Amateur Radio Astronomers, explained to Newsline that the system monitors those signals around the clock and records ionospheric changes caused by the sun. If there's time, he said, he'd also like to operate the special event station K6S, too. So stop by if you're in the area, or be listening if you're not. For Amateur Radio Newsline, I'm Dave Parks, WB8ODF.
The weekend of October 13th and 14th has been set aside for Europe's big international QSO party, and Ed Durant, DD5LP, has those details.
The next big international QSO party is being hosted by the European Radio Amateurs Organization, and the group is calling it Journey of Discovery. The activity is entirely on 60 meters or 5 megahertz, and it's been organized to encourage the use of this relatively new band for hams in many countries. Get on 5 MHz on October 13th and 14th and operate SSB, CW or digital modes. It's that easy. Participating hams are being asked to call CQEURAO Party. And you needn't worry about a contact turning into a rag chew. That kind of exchange is being encouraged, with discussions on every topic ranging from the weather, ham shack equipment, or even the city you're transmitting from. Hams are also encouraged to exchange QSL cards, but it is not a contest, and even QSL cards are not necessary. To help organisers gather statistics, logs can be submitted to the email address party@eurao.org in ADIF format with the file name as the ham's call sign. Logs will not qualify for prizes if, however, you submit a log on which at least 10% of your QSOs are confirmed, you will receive a certificate of participation. For Amateur Radio Newsline, I'm Ed Durant, DD5LP.
A hospital emergency drill in Ohio got some very real response from hams there recently, as we hear from Phil Thomas, W8RMJ, courtesy of Amateur News Weekly.
MARA, the Mound Amateur Radio Association, located in Miamisburg, Ohio, assisted the Kettering Health Network in a simulated exercise on Thursday, September the 20th. MARA provided communication support at Sycamore Hospital, located in Miamisburg, Ohio, and at the Kettering's new Franklin Emergency Urgent Care Facility, located in Franklin, Ohio. MARA club members assisting in this exercise included Frank, KM8N, Mike, W8VMR, Ken, AC8AV, Bill, KE8JDU, and Dave, NADAT. The Mound Amateur Radio Association was formed in 1962 by employees of the Mound Atomic Energy Facility. MARA's club and meeting room and operational amateur shack is now located in the Mound Historical Park, also located within Miamisburg, Ohio.
That was Phil Thomas, W8RMJ of Amateur News Weekly. For more news of the Ohio, Kentucky, and Indiana area, visit AmateurNewsWeekly.com. In this week's World of DX, CG DL7DF is operating until October 15th as SV8/DL7DF from Zakynthos Island. Listen for him on 80 through 10 meters using CW, single sideband, and RIDI. His log will be uploaded within 6 months after the activation has concluded. Send QSLs via DL7DF direct or by the DARC Bureau. Listen for Bertrand, DF3FS, operating as TU5MH from the Ivory Coast between the 20th and 29th of October. Bertrand will be on various HF bands using CW and single sideband. QSL via DF3FS or Logbook of the World. QSL requests are being accepted also via Club Logs OQRS, and your own card is not needed. Please do not send QSLs via the Bureau. Use the OQRS system from Club Log for confirmation via the Bureau. And our final story is about some low-power transmitters making their way through the swamps of the UK. As Jeremy Boot, G4NJH, explains, they're operating mobile atop a group of endangered lizards.
Satellites, weather balloons, and other more traditional venues for transmitters have just acquired some unusual company, 24 sand lizards, living in Ealmore Marsh, Farnborough in the UK. Just think of it as lizards on the air, but without any clever award scheme. These lizards are the UK's rarest, and according to a report in the Warrington Guardian, two dozen are now wearing lightweight radio trackers to help scientists at Marwell Wildlife Zoo follow them and study their behaviour, although the trackers are not even 5% of the creature's body weight. University of Southampton PhD student Rachel Gardner told the newspaper that the lizards blend in very well with the environment and as such would be lost from sight in the dense undergrowth. She said their wearing transmitters will make them easier to follow as they make their way through the habitat. The lizard is found throughout Europe and Asia, but has become the focus of conservation efforts in England and Wales, where its numbers have been diminishing. The radio tags are expected to stay in place for a while, or at least until the animals shed their skins, at which point one can assume the lizards will be going QRT. For Amateur Radio Newsline, I'm Jeremy Boot, G4NJH.
With thanks to Allen Labs, Amateur News Weekly, the ARRL, CQ Magazine, EURAO Newsletter, Lloyd Colston, KC5 FM, Hap Holly and the Rain Report, the Irish Radio Transmitter Society, K2BSA, the Ohio Penn DX Bulletin, Sonoma County Radio Amateurs Club, Southgate Amateur Radio News, Ted Randall's QSO Radio Show, Variety, Wireless Institute of Australia, WTWW Shortwave, and you, our listeners. That's all from the Amateur Radio Newsline. Send emails to our address at newsline@arnewsline.org. More information is available at Amateur Radio Newsline's only official website at www.arnewsline.org. For now, with Karen Eve Marie, KD2GUT, at the news desk in New York, and our news team worldwide, I'm Paul Brown, WD9GCO in Valparaiso, Indiana, saying 73. And as always, we thank you for listening. Amateur Radio Newsline is copyright 2018. All rights reserved.
From the headquarters of the American Radio Relay League in Newington, Connecticut, this is ARRL, The Doctor Is In, a bi-weekly podcast addressing common and some not-so-common technical issues in amateur radio. This podcast is brought to you by DX Engineering, helping you shrink the globe. See their website at www.dxengineering.com. And now, here's your host, QST Editor-in-Chief Steve Ford, WB8IMY, and the Doctor himself, QST Contributing Editor Joel Hallis, W1ZR.
Hello and welcome to The Doctor Is In. I'm Steve Ford, WB8IMY.
And I'm Joel Hallis, W1ZR.
This podcast, Joel, is only for those living in the northern United States. The rest of you can just tune out at this point, right? No.
Like everybody does.
Yeah. No, I'm kidding. Everybody, I think, could use this to one degree or another, and that is winterizing, because by the time everybody hears this, winter will be upon us, and no matter where you live, there is a certain effect, one way or the other. I mean, we get quite a brutal effect up here in Connecticut with ice and snow and everything else, but pretty much wherever you live, there's something, isn't there?
I suppose there is, but some people have to worry more about snake bites and bee attacks than they have to worry about ice and snow, but that's okay.
Yeah. Earthquakes.
That's true. And most of us are fortunate enough to have our station operating positions located indoors where the weather doesn't usually get to in any direction. Like right now, around where we are, it's pretty darn hot, which happens to people a lot of them, maybe more than it used to. Still, we have to remember that after we change our screens to storm windows and turn up the heat, we have to remember that some of our most important station assets are out in the cold, or out in the elements, whatever kind of elements you have where you are. Not only are the antennas outside, but if they need repair or adjustments, we need to go outside to deal with them.
And so it's better to do that now than having to go out there in, say, January or
December. What I'm thinking. It is much easier to make adjustments to antennas with your bare hands than with heavy winter gloves on. If you try to do it in your bare hands, and it's very cold out there, you'll find your fingers will freeze to the beam elements or to the tower, and then you have to wait till spring to get back in the house. So that can be a serious problem.
Don't put your tongue on the...
Yes, don't put your tongue on your tower. That's a rule that you should live by, I mean, really. While it's easy to work on the antennas, and rather than waiting until it's hard to work on it. But in addition to that, there are some things that happen when things get cold. Now, one of the things is that things tend to get smaller when they're cold. And so if you have antenna wires between structures, they tend to get tighter, putting more stress on everything that's part of the system. So one thing I like to do is reduce the halyard tension on my wire antennas before it gets really cold. Also, another thing that adds to the stress on antennas is ice and snow buildup on wires and transmission lines. If you operate a lot and keep power in your system, it tends to melt the stuff, but you can't do that day and night, and or most of us can't do it day and night. So another reason to reduce halyard tension, because the additional load of the snow and ice will tend to pull against the antenna to cause it to be more likely to break.
Now, when you were talking about the temperature of the wire, is that really significant when it gets quite cold? I mean, the shrinkage of the wire?
Yeah, I mean, a 100-degree drop, which is Not something that happens in a day, but it can happen between winter and summer easily, because right now, today, Connecticut, it's almost 100 degrees, and mm-hmm. it won't be long before it's 0 degrees.
Yeah.
So that's 100 degrees. That will cause 100 feet of wire or coax to shrink by about an inch.
Really?
Yes.
Wow. Okay.
Drive down the street and look at your utility poles and the wires between. Look at the coax for the cable TV people, if you have that running on your poles. And you'll find every 100 feet or so, there's a sort of an exaggerated U-shaped section.
Yes.
And that's there exactly for that reason, so that the transmission line won't pull out of the devices that are connected to, which can happen. End connectors in particular. End connectors are very good connectors. But if they are subject to contraction, the center conductor does not have to pull very far out of the connection arrangement to disconnect the center conductor of the plug from the jack. And that actually has been known to happen. So if you have a tight coax arrangement on end connectors, you may be asking for trouble. I don't think that'll happen the same way with UHF mm-hmm. connectors, because the center pin and the back shell are sort of part of the same assembly. But in the end connector, the inner conductor is assembled separately, and it actually can pull back. And if it's in perfect alignment,
yes.
you can actually end up with it disconnected. I've never had that happen to me, but I've been told that people have experienced that. So that's something that can happen.
I just never considered the shrinkage of wire.
Well, that's
never
why we're here. To me.
That's why we're here, yes. See, I learn something every podcast.
Well, that's good. Yes. I do, too. Another thing that cold does, and I guess hot does in the opposite direction, is can result in lubricants being much stiffer. And if in real hot conditions, lubricants tend to run out and provide less lubrication, so that goes either way. But for us, cold lubricants tend to drag more. So if you've got systems that are greased so they can move with respect to each other, and this would include perhaps the bearings around your antenna rotator, your thrust bearing, people have antenna towers that can go up and down with steel cables that are lubricated, the lubricant gets much stiffer in the winter and in the summer, and it can be harder to move. Now what that does is that applies additional stress to your motor-driven arrangements that are causing things to move and so forth. So I don't think it's reasonable to expect anybody to actually change from one grade of lubricant in the summer to the winter. But if you're due for doing a grease change or relube parts of your antenna system, why not do it in the fall before it gets cold or before it gets hot if you want to get more effective lubrication in a hot zone? And make sure your lubricants are up to date, because whatever was going on with them will be exaggerated by the temperature. You know, the tighter the lubricant is, the harder everything has to work, and the more likely is something's going to snap. Another thing that happens with ice and snow is if you have coax connectors in the field. Now, of course, all UHF connectors should be carefully wrapped. The cables will ruin from the ends in if
yes.
the water gets into them. So you got to keep them waterproof. But if you need to change them, what happens is sometimes you can get an inch of ice around your coax connectors out there in the field. And we don't get that so much here, but people in some parts of the country that are even worse in the winter than we are.
Alaska, northern New Hampshire, northern Vermont, Minnesota. Yeah.
Northern Michigan, all those places where we try to stay away from in the winter. You know, if you had an inch of ice around the tape that's holding your connectors together, you're in trouble. You're not going to get that apart. What I suggest is taking some of that kitchen cling wrap stuff we use to put over jars and stuff in the refrigerator and wrap a couple of turns around the connector. Don't wrap them tight, but just leave a little space in it. So if you get the ice, it'll be on top of that. And then if you just flex it a little bit, you should be able to break the ice out and then peel off the plastic wrap, and then you're into your tape.
Sure.
So I think things like that could...
That's a good idea.
Yeah, could make things a lot easier. Now, I do that to waterproof my Christmas tree lights that are outside, where the extension cords go together. I use the same technique. But it occurs to me it would work here as well. And it also provides a little additional waterproofing, because while the tape may keep rainwater from accumulating in your around your connectors, it might not be suitable if it's tightly wrapped around. You know, if you have ice right around that that's melting, it's going to be there and it's going to work its way into things. So your waterproofing will not be as effective if you're encased in ice, I don't think.
Okay. So. Okay. Let's take a quick break, Joel. We'll hear from DX Engineering and
okay.
we will be back.
Every ham radio operator knows speed matters. Whether it's jumping in your truck during an emergency or staying up all night for lightning-quick contesting, seconds count. And there's nothing more painful than being off the air waiting for equipment to arrive. At DX Engineering, we know a thing or two about speed. You can count on us to provide the fastest shipping in the ham universe. How fast? You get same-day shipping on most orders placed by 10 p.m. Eastern Time. It's that fast. So that new rig, antenna, cable assembly, or replacement part you need will make it to your shack in plenty of time to work a remote DXCC entity or dominate the competition in the next contest. And the best part is, DX Engineering offers free shipping for most orders over $99. Radio waves travel at the speed of light. Lucky for you, so does DX Engineering. Visit dxengineering.com. That's dxengineering.com.
And we're back, Joel. Now, a person that just has an ordinary dipole hanging up in their backyard, do they have to do anything for winter as far as that center connector?
I wouldn't think so. I think the thing to remember is that, again, that with ice on the, if the connector is hanging there, you're going to have additional stress of everything pulling down on it. So,
yes.
You know, make sure there's stress relief on that connector. This is independent of the seasons, but don't have your coax cable hanging. You know, even a wrap of a turn of the coax around the center insulator and tie with a tie wrap or something. Don't do that with foam dielectric coax.
No.
I guess in a number of publications, I've described a thing that was in QST where someone used a heavy-duty line, string kind of line, to make a sort of like a Chinese finger trap. You remember those finger?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Around the cable to hold the cable without squeezing it too much, and use that to as a strain so that the pressure is not on the connector.
That's clever.
Nothing worse than looking out there and your coax connector is still connected to your antenna, but your antenna feed line is on the ground.
Feed line's on the ground.
And that's more likely to happen if it has a half an inch of ice on it.
Yes. Now, what about folks like me who have remote antenna tuners outdoors? I have one that feeds my multiband dipole. It's allegedly weatherproofed or waterproof, but anything you would suggest for that?
Well, I guess it depends on how much you believe that.
Well, that's what I mean, yeah.
And there's being resistant to rainwater falling upon it is one thing. That probably doesn't mean it will be resistant to being immersed in water. And if you have something covered in snow, you know, it's not unusual to have 2 feet of snow around here.
Sure.
You have water at all levels sitting there against it. So I would think it wouldn't hurt to have something else around it, a plastic food container or something to keep the snow away from it.
Even a trash bag or something? Seriously.
Well, a trash bag wouldn't, you know, would help, I would think. Or just one of the plastic waste basket or something.
Well, that's true. Yes.
Just keep the snow off of it, because when it melts, you can't. I don't know that you could assume that it will start to melt at the bottom.
No.
If it starts to melt at the top and it's still frozen at the bottom, that means part of the middle of it is going to be covered with wet water while it's going through the melting process.
And wet water.
Wet water as opposed to hard water.
Or heavy water.
Yes,
or,
heavy water.
Yeah. So. Okay. Well, how about a question? Are you ready?
Okay.
And this is from Art, WD6BQX. And he's asking, I was wondering if I could install two perpendicular dipole antennas and connect them with only a single feed line. This way I would have only one feed line and would not have to change anything to cover a different area. I've seen that done, or something similar to that done before.
Well, you have, but there's a couple of fine points here.
Yes.
Unfortunately, if you just connect two horizontal dipoles together at the feed point, if they're perpendicular, let's say, what you won't end up with what you expect. What you'll end up with is not the patterns of two dipoles, but the two patterns will actually add in such a way that you'll have pattern as if it were a single dipole at 45 degrees.
Oh.
And which is not bad, but you've gone to a lot of trouble to get something you didn't want. So I wouldn't recommend that. Now, to get a nearly omnidirectional pattern from a pair of perpendicular dipoles, you need to feed them 90 degrees out of phase. And that's probably what you've seen. You can do this by putting an electrical quarter wavelength of transmission line between them, or just make one feed line a quarter wave longer than the other if you have two feed lines. And you'll end up with a turnstile antenna.
You're right. That's what I've seen.
And that's almost omnidirectional. It has a little more gain some directions than a dipole. But notice that this is frequency dependent. It only works on one band where that's 90 degrees.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, it worked for a single band just fine. But the other thing to mention is that you're at your height of 20 feet that you said your antenna was. The dipoles are not all that directional. The nulls off the end that we see in free space patterns get less and less pronounced as the antenna is lowered. So if it's, say, an 80-meter dipole or something, the nulls might only be down 6 decibels or so. And you're talking on 80 meters for near vertical incident sky wave operation. Large radiation is going to mostly be going up. So what that says to me is maybe you're close enough to omnidirectional with just one antenna. And if that's the case, then maybe what you want to do is have the other antenna be one for a different frequency. So you can talk in two different directions, favoring two different directions, but on two different frequency bands, which can be more advantageous maybe.
Yes.
But you certainly could do it. So, you know, 6 dB is one S unit, but maybe that's not as big a difference. On NVIS, usually signals are pretty strong. Now, the other advantage is if the two antennas are on different frequencies, like one on 80 and one on 40 meters, for example, you can connect them directly together to the single coax and the signals will just go to the right one depending on the band, as we discussed some time back, because the impedances are different. So consider that as an alternative, is to have more flexibility by having the two antennas on two bands. If you've got the supports in the right place for perpendicular antennas, that should be great. In fact, that's a great solution for an antenna mounted on one of the popular 40-foot push-up masts, because you can use the two dipoles as wires, upper guy wires, for the two bands. Probably on 40 feet, you probably want two in the middle as well, which would be not metal. But I recommend that as a very handy, easy-to-deploy emergency communication antenna for 80 and 40, the pop EIS bands.
That would
bands.
Be, yeah.
And it's very easy to put up, and it works very well, and it just requires one coax, and there you go. So anyway, but that's sort of getting off your question, but it's more complicated than just hooking two antennas together to get the combination of the results of the two of them, because the combination is not what you get on one in addition to what you get on the other.
Or to put it one way, there's no such thing as a free lunch.
That's true.
Okay. Thank you, Joel.
My pleasure.
ARRL, The Doctor Is In, is brought to you by DX Engineering, helping you shrink the globe. See their website at www.dxengineering.com. For more information on amateur radio or the ARRL, visit us on the web at www.arrl.org. You can also find us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter by searching for ARRL. If you have a question or comment for the doctor, send an email to doctor@arrl.org. Background music is courtesy of Ben Sound at www.bensound.com. This program is provided under the copyright of the ARRL. Until next time, I'm QST Managing Editor Becky Schoenfeld, W1BXY 73, and thanks for listening.
Hallo, liebe SWLs, YLs und OM, Sie hören den Deutschlandrundspruch Nummer 41 des Deutschen Amateurradioclubs für die 41. Kalenderwoche 2018. Diesmal haben wir Meldungen zu folgenden Themen. Präsentationen der Hemnet-Tagung sind jetzt online abrufbar. Dann gibt es eine aktuelle Satellitenliste für den Amateurfunk, Spielfilm bei der ARD und Amateurfunkgeräte. Aktivierung des Notfunknetzes in Kuba ist ein weiteres Thema hier im Deutschlandrundspruch. Dann haben wir Termine im Programm, aktuelle Konteste und was gibt es Neues vom Funkwetter. Zum ersten Thema im Deutschlandrundspruch, Präsentationen der Hemnet-Tagung online. Am 29. September fand die vierte Hemnet-Tagung an der Hochschule Bremen statt. Die Präsentationen stehen nun zum Download auf der Webseite der IP-Koordination Deutschland bereit. Im Menü wählen Sie dazu bitte Meetings aus. Inhaltlich erfuhren die Tagungsbesucher den aktuellen Status des Hemnet Backbones. Innerhalb des vergangenen Jahres wurden viele Lücken geschlossen, auch dank der Förderung durch die DARC-Mitgliedschaft Pro. Weitere Themen waren die Funktionsweise der HemCloud und die Implementierung des Hemnet-weiten Monitorings. Der Einladung zur Hemnet-Tagung folgten etwa 50 YLs und OM mit teils sehr weiten Anfahrtswegen. Die erstmals weiter im Norden der Republik stattfindende Tagung erleichterte auch Teilnehmern aus Flensburg und Rügen die Entscheidung zur Anreise, um sich ausgiebig über das Thema Hemnet zu informieren und auszutauschen. Die Vorbereitungen an der Hochschule Bremen waren wesentlich von Professor Dr. Ingenieur Michael Hartje, Delta Kilo 5 Hotel Hotel, vorgenommen worden. Aktuelle Satellitenliste für Amateurfunk. Mineo Wakita, Juliet Echo 9, Papa Echo Lima, hat sich die Arbeit gemacht und eine aktuelle Liste von Amateurfunksatelliten erstellt. Diese stellt er auf seiner Webseite in verschiedenen Formaten, darunter als Word- und Excel-Datei, zur Verfügung. Weiterhin stellt er auch eine Doppler-SQF-Datei zur Verfügung, die man in die bekannte Software SAT-PC32 einlesen kann. Die Liste mit Stand 8. Oktober ist über die Webseite von JE9PEL abrufbar. Darüber informiert das britische Nachrichtenportal Southgate. Spielfilm bei der ARD und Amateurfunkgeräte. Am 13. Oktober zeigt das erste um 20.15 Uhr den Spielfilm Endlich Gardasee. Für die Requisite wurde eine Amateurfunkstation benötigt, wobei die Regisseurin sehr genaue Wünsche hinsichtlich der Geräte hatte. Diese Geräte konnten von Günter Schliwienski, Delta Charlie 9 Hotel Lima, aus dem Ortsverband Hamburg Ost, Echo 14, bereitgestellt und am Drehort in Hamburg-Niendorf wunschgemäß aufgebaut werden. Die Filmgesellschaft äußerte sich sehr zufrieden über die schnelle, kompetente und zuverlässige Hilfe durch Mitglieder des Ortsverbandes ECHO 14 sowie die Beratung des Darstellers Willem Menne. Eine Hauptrolle in dem Film spielt Cornelia Frohbös. Die erste Kontaktaufnahme für das Filmprojekt erfolgte durch Relevant Film in Hamburg bereits im Herbst 2017. Man fragte, ob es möglich sei, eine Amateurfunkstation oder Funkgeräte für einen Spielfilm aufzubauen. Die Station musste nicht betriebsbereit sein, aber in einem Film, Arbeitstitel »Meine Oma spinnt«, würde sie zusammen mit einem der Hauptdarsteller eine Rolle spielen. Günther, DC9HL, hat diverse Geräte zusammengestellt, die aus zeitlichen Gründen fotografiert und somit schnell vorgestellt werden konnten. Von der Regie kam nach Sichtung der Bilder und einigen Änderungswünschen danach das Okay. Am Drehort wurde ein Regal genau passend für die Geräte vorgestellt und die Funkgeräte wurden dort eingebaut. Leider durfte aus rechtlichen Gründen bisher keine DVD mit dem Film herausgegeben werden. Über das Internet kann man aber mehr über den Film und seine Handlung erfahren. Der Film wird am 14. Oktober um 1.30 Uhr im ersten wiederholt und dürfte danach auch in der Mediathek des Senders bereitstehen. Aktivierung des Notfunknetzes in Kuba. Auf der karibischen Insel Kuba wurden die Notfunknetze im 80- und 40-Meter-Band wegen der Auswirkungen des Hurrikans Michael aktiviert. Die Frequenzen, die bis auf Weiteres genutzt werden, lauten 40 Meter primär 7110 kHz, 40 Meter sekundär 7120, auf 80 Meter primär 3740 kHz sowie sekundär 3720 kHz. Als Betriebsart sind je nach Bedarf SSB und digitale Modes vorgesehen. Darüber berichten verschiedene Quellen aus dem Bereich der Notfunkaktivisten. Termine am 13. Oktober, das ist der kommende Samstag, findet die 15. Amateurfunk-, Rundfunk- und Elektronikbörse, kurz AREB, in den Räumen der TU Dresden in der Dülferstraße Nummer 1 in 01069 Dresden statt. Öffnungszeit für Besucher ist von 9 bis 15 Uhr. Es werden wieder über 1000 Besucher aus ganz Europa erwartet. Das 64. Treffen des Bayerischen Bergtages findet am 13. und 14. Oktober in St. Engelmar statt. Los geht's am Samstag im Gasthof Rainer, Grün Nummer 8, mit einem Flohmarkt, einer Präsentation der Geräte des Selbstbauwettbewerbs und am Nachmittag mit der Preisverteilung des Wettbewerbs. Am Sonntag trifft man sich dann zum technischen Frühschoppen im Bugelhof Glashütt Nummer 1. Einen detaillierten Ablaufplan findet man auf der BBT-Webseite. Auf eine Veranstaltung in der Volkshochschule Würzburg weist OM Bernd Delta Hotel 5 India Sierra hin. Am 19. Oktober findet dort von 18.30 Uhr bis 20 Uhr ein Vortrag mit dem Thema Amateurfunk heute noch aktuell statt. Aktuelle Conteste an diesem Wochenende, 13. Oktober, da laufen der VFDB-Contest auf 80 und 40 Meter, das sind die Teile 5 und 6, sowie die Komi Ruhrgebiet Memoriam QSO-Party. Dann das ganze Wochenende hindurch, 13. 14. Oktober in Kalifornien, der Macrothon-Contest, das ist ein RTTY-Wettbewerb, dann der Oceania DX-Contest sowie der Scandinavian Activity-Contest. Außerdem noch am Sonntag, dem 14. Oktober, der Oscar-November-Contest auf 80 Meter in Belgien. Am 15. Oktober, da ist der internationale White-Stick-Day und dementsprechend findet dann auch ein White-Stick-Day-Contest statt. Am nächsten Wochenende, 20. Oktober, Bayern-Ost-Contest sowie ein Ausbildungskontest im Rahmen des Worked All Germany. Das ganze Wochenende hindurch, 20. 21. Oktober, dann der Worked All Germany-Contest, kurz WAG. Und außerdem kommt aus Japan der JARTS Worldwide RTTY-Contest zu uns. Außerdem gibt's noch am 21. Oktober den Bayern-Ost-Contest und den Oscar-November-Contest auf 2 Meter. Die Ausschreibungen finden Sie auf der Webseite des Contest-Referates sowie mittels der Contest-Termintabelle in der CQDL in der Ausgabe 10 2018 auf Seite 56. Der Funkwetterbericht vom 9. Oktober, herausgegeben von Hartmut Büttig, DL1 VDL. Zunächst Rückblick vom 30. September bis 8. Oktober. Bei einem durchschnittlichen Wert von 69 solaren Fluxeinheiten war die Sonne unverändert sehr ruhig. Die Region 27-23 war auch nur eine inaktive Zierde auf der uns zugewandten Sonnenscheibe. Es war wieder nur der Sonnenwind, der das Funkwetter bestimmte. Nach sehr ruhigen geomagnetischen Bedingungen bis zum Mittag des 1. Oktober folgte die erste Störung mit K gleich 4. Die Störung beruhigte sich am Morgen des Folgetages. Der 3. und 4. Oktober brachte ein ruhiges geomagnetisches Feld, bevor es am 5. und 6. Oktober jeweils in den ersten drei Morgenstunden wieder unruhig wurde. Die geomagnetische Unruhe verstärkte sich am 7. und 8. Oktober. Trotz dieser unvorhersagbaren Schwankungen des Erdmagnetfeldes konnte man in den aktiven Störungsphasen auf den Bändern zwischen 160 und 40 Meter interessante DX-Signale finden, zumal das atmosphärische Störpotenzial niedrig war. Die Bänder 20 und 17 Meter waren auf den Taglinien an den meisten Tagen brauchbar. Am Sonntagnachmittag gab es für die VHF-Freunde nochmals Tropobedingungen kurz vor dem Contest-Ende. Vorhersage bis zum 16. Oktober. Aus heutiger Sicht bleibt die Sonnenaktivität sehr ruhig. Die nächste, aufgrund der Rotation der koronalen Löcher, vorhersagbare geomagnetische Störung erwarten wir am 19. Oktober, kurz vor dem WAG-Contest. Bis zum 16. Oktober wird das geomagnetische Feld weitestgehend ruhig sein. Das verspricht gute Ausbreitungsbedingungen auf den unteren Bändern und auch Öffnungen aller Funkwege auf den Taglinien bis 17 Meter. Und hier noch die Orientierungszeiten für Greyline DX alle Zeiten in UTC. Sonnenaufgang in Neuseeland ist um 17.46 Uhr, in Ostaustralien um 19.44 Uhr, in Westaustralien um 21.45 Uhr, in Singapur geht die Sonne auf um 22.49 Uhr Weltzeit, in Japan um 20.41 Uhr, auf Hawaii um 16.24 Uhr. Sonnenaufgang in Anchorage in Alaska ist um 16.23 Uhr Weltzeit, in Johannesburg in Südafrika um 3.39 Uhr, an der USA-Westküste in Kalifornien um 14.12 Uhr, auf den Falklandinseln um 9.07 Uhr und in Berlin in Deutschland geht die Sonne um 5.20 Uhr Weltzeit auf. Sonnenuntergang USA-Ostküste 22.25 Uhr, USA-Westküste 1.41 Uhr, in Sao Paulo in Brasilien, dort geht die Sonne unter um 21.08 Uhr Weltzeit, auf den Falklandinseln um 22.22 Uhr, auf Hawaii um 4.11 Uhr, in Anchorage in Alaska, dort geht die Sonne unter um 3.03 Uhr UTC, in Johannesburg in Südafrika um 16.11 Uhr, in Neuseeland um 6.31 Uhr und in Berlin in Deutschland verschwindet die Sonne um 16.26 Uhr UTC hinter dem Horizont. Das war der DARC Deutschlandrundspruch für diese Woche. Die Redaktion hatte diesmal Stefan Hüpper, DH5FFL vom Amateurfunkmagazin CQDL. Wenn Sie Meldungen für den Deutschlandrundspruch haben, also Infos und Beiträge mit bundesweiter Relevanz, dann schicken Sie Ihre Texte gerne per Post oder Fax an die Redaktion CQDL. Sie kennen ja die bekannte Adresse Lindenallee 4 in Baunatal, sowie per E-Mail bitte ausschließlich an die Adresse redaktion@darc.de. Diesen Rundspruch gibt's auch als PDF und MP3-Datei auf der DARC-Webseite, in Packet Radio unter der Rubrik DARC sowie per E-Mail-Abonnement. Über die DARC-Webseite können Sie sich dazu jederzeit an- und abmelden. Bitte bewahren Sie dazu Ihre Mitgliedsnummer und Ihr Passwort stets griffbereit auf. Vielen Dank fürs Zuhören und AWDH. Bis zur nächsten Woche.
Und an alle Mächers, 88.
PA00 News følgende udsendelse indeholder nogle chokerende eksempler på, hvordan en hobby kan ændre liv i unge under 18. Kraftigt tilstedeværelsen af en voksen anbefales.
7, 8, 4, 0, 5, 1, 2, 7, 4, 8, 9, 7. Achtung alle Mitarbeiter der Nachrichtendienste, bitte beachten Sie freitagabends die Sendungen PA00 News für die wichtigsten weitere Informationen.
Dit is Papa Alpha 0 Echo Tango Echo.